Hello, and welcome to the Warm Podcast, where we discuss the current state and future of the music industry. We talk to some of the most interesting behind-the-scenes leaders, trendsetters, and entrepreneurs who are shaping the music business today. My name is Fabian, and today we'll be talking to Peter Harris, founder of the pioneering new streaming service Resonate. Resonate calls itself the ethical streaming service and sets itself apart from services like Spotify and Apple Music in a number of key ways. Resonate uses a so-called stream-to-own model, which they say is a more fair and transparent way of paying artists for use of their music. This is especially true for upcoming and independent artists. Peter and I discuss these issues, as well as the streaming market in general, how Resonate is fighting for a more diverse music industry, and much more. Thanks for tuning in. I hope you enjoy. Could you give me a little bit of your own background with regards to music and tech? What's your background?
I sort of had a day job and a night hobby, building websites by day and then doing music stuff at night. And that ranged everything from being in bands to being a singer-songwriter to producing and DJing. And it was just something that was always a part of my life. I mean, I think I certainly had dreams of fame, but it has become really clear to me as time has gone on that the real reason for doing all of that was so that I could understand, you know, the needs of artists and musicians in order to do Resonate.
Mm-hmm. But you also, you also released music, as my understanding, and kind of had weren't satisfied with the streaming services that you came across. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, I've worked with pretty much everything that's ever been around, and I think the common thread through all of that was I'm putting my music there, I'm putting time into it, I'm helping to promote this platform by trying to drive people to go to use it, and yet that's it. You know, you don't get any more participation. And the one story I always go back to is the morning I woke up and found that half of my catalog on SoundCloud was gone. That they had changed their business model, and I would now have to pay to host all of the same files up that I had up. And, you know, all of those experiences really kind of built up over time. And then I've heard enough stories from other friends, you know, about things like not getting paid for 3 years, and they're writing songs for a Grammy winning album, and that's in the top 10, and it takes them 3 to 4 years to get paid because they're a songwriter. You know, just these horror stories. And it's like, there's just no other industry on earth, I think, that takes so long to pay its main supplier. You know, somebody makes a chair and they get paid for the chair when it's shipped out of the warehouse. You know, and maybe in a B2B, business to business, you might be like, you get paid in 30 days, you know, worst case 60 days. But the fact that artists can get, you know, that the payments can come years later is just outrageous. And so a lot of these different stories really had kind of stored in the back of my mind. And then when things really switched on is when I got into blockchain, and I saw that there was a way that you could have a technology that could have fairness as the core operating system and the core value, both in the code and then through the cooperative as the form of the business with the company. And I thought that was the perfect blend of the two. And so that's what really inspired me to go after this and decide to do something, because it really felt like the time is right for something like this.
Mm. But I mean, if for those who don't know, could you just, briefly explain how a typical streaming service like Spotify or Apple Music, how they work with regards to how artists get paid, and why what you felt was wrong with that?
Yeah. So how do artists get paid typically on other services? It really depends on who they are. So if you're with a label, you're going through the label and your payments will come through them. If you're an independent, you'll be going through an aggregator like DistroKid or CD Baby. And so then the payments can go to you. The thing about delays, payment delays can, it depends on what, you know, what kind of deal you're in. So there'll be a delay coming from the service provider. Then if it goes to a label, there's a delay coming from a label. But then there's also the publishing side of things, which is as the writer, because in music, in music, you have two different types of credits and two different sets of rights. You've got the composition and the master, you know, and so the publishers control the composition rights, and labels or independent artists usually are in control of the master. And so it's more on the publishing side that you see these really long delays, but you know, some artists, if they're on a major, you know, they can see delays on payments for the use of the master. So it's bad across the board.
But you also, I mean, did you also have a problem with like, because on Spotify, you know, if you as an individual user are streaming a certain indie band, almost exclusively, that money doesn't go directly to them. It all goes into like a big pot, and it gets divided from that.
Yeah,
was that also one of the things you saw was wrong with the other model?
Yeah, so I had the idea of blockchain and the cooperative. All of that stuff was at the very beginning, and then from there, I spent quite a lot of time researching why were all these artists, and this is like around 2015. Why were all these artists saying that the payment models of all these services are terrible? And that's where you have this paradigm of the market share model, as you described. It's all the money goes into a big pot, and it's divided up in this through this complex formula, and then it's made even worse by Spotify's model of, you know, ad supported versus premium paid supported, or so the formula is crazy complicated. It used to be on SpotifyArtist.com. They've taken it down. I've never found it again. Since then, there's a different model called the subscriber share, and that's apparently Deezer is like very close to implementing it or is trying it out, and that's the idea that you can still have a monthly fee, but your money is distributed amongst those artists that you're listening to, and it's based on a individual subscriber level instead of this whole giant pile. And I think if we were going to do a monthly streaming model, that's definitely what we would do. That idea wasn't even around 3 years ago. So what I realized would be the most applicable to blockchain is the idea of credits. Because then if you've got microcredits, then you can have the same stream rate for everything. And so you just have this clear sense of fairness around every play is a certain price, and you know it's always paid for unless the artist says it's free.
Interesting. So could you explain the stream to own concept, which is one of the things that really sets Resonate apart?
Yeah, it's fairly simple. Stream to own is basically breaking up the payment of a download over 9 plays. And it's a nice gradually increasing scale. So it starts off really cheap when you're just getting to know an artist for a song. And then it gets more expensive when you cross over into being a fan. And same cost as you'd pay for a download. And that's where it's really a better model because even if you have subscriber share versus market share, you're still running into this possibility that you're going to be paying like fractions of a penny per play. And economically, this is just, there's just no comparison at all. And there's this data designer who runs under this project called Information is Beautiful. They've been doing reports on this for the last couple of years, and they keep updating the numbers. And they just did the update for 2018, and it's, you got to have like, to earn a minimum wage, which in the U.S. is a joke anyway. It's like $1,200. It's not even close to what it actually takes to live and survive. There's very few places in the United States where you can live on $1,200. But to make that minimum, you've got to hit something like 200 to 300,000 plays. And, so you really got to like triple that to actually reach a livable wage. And then that doesn't account. Like if you're a band and you've got to split that five ways, you know, and it's just, if you look at the cost comparison against, physical product and downloads, the economics are just a nightmare. It just doesn't compare. So that's what we are also trying to do, is to try to find a way to bridge this convenience and low cost of streaming, but then have some very seamless, easy mechanism to become a fan of something and pay a bit more to the people whose music you love.
Yeah. So you pay for every stream, you pay a little bit more, and then you stream it a certain amount of times, and then you own it. You get to download it. Is that how it is?
Yeah. It's on repeat plays. You know. It's all the same for every single song. Like this, that's the formula is the same for every song. You pay just slightly incrementally more the more you listen to the same song again. And what this does is it allows you to like not have any pressure at all about just getting to know something and improving my own interaction and behavior with the service since we started working on it. And you know, I would say it's probably 1 in 50 songs that you hear once and you're an instant fan. The majority of the stuff that we come to like and come to love, it takes listening to it 3 or 4 times. And so it's the transition around the 4th, the 5th, the 6th play. That's where the price starts to go up. But at that point, you're either in love with something or you're not. And usually when you're in love with a song and an artist, it's like you just have to have it. You know, there's a feeling like I need to be connected to them in some way. And, you know, so we're a service that's oriented to fans that like to spend money on music because they are out there. This whole myth that nobody pays for music is a complete lie. It's just not true. There's a great deal of market data to prove that that's not true. And so that's our target audience. We want people that care about artists. They recognize that music is art and culture. It's not content, and they want to support it.
Yeah, because that's one of the things that I actually thought about when I read about the stream to own. If people are still interested in owning music, you know, in the digital space, because there's certainly like you get the impression through the media that that's not the case. You're saying that is the case for some people.
I think that it's still too early to say that definitively whether that's the case. Yeah. Streaming as a viable revenue stream has only had a couple of years. You know, it's so far away from really being an entrenched paradigm. You know, it's just. But I think that there's new ideas of ownership models or ownership concepts that we've yet to explore. We've started looking at them for the redesign that we're doing at the moment. And I'm not going to say exactly what they are, but I think there's different ways of owning something or being connected as a supporter that isn't necessarily about moving a file around on your computer. But I mean, that does have, you know, some advantages of, you know, bandwidth and stuff. So it doesn't matter whether you want to stream to own or you want to stream to support. This is really about a model where you want to pay for what you love.
Yeah. What about the co-op model, where I understand that if the artists and the users own the streaming service, like they have a share, so everyone kind of owns it together. Is that right?
Yep. Yeah, so listeners buy their shares and artists earn their shares by supplying music, and workers, volunteers, and all that also earn a share that way. And this is a very typical model called a worker consumer co-op.
Mm-hmm. So musicians, they supply the music and then they have a share. They don't need to be streamed a certain amount or something like that.
No, they don't. We may have to build in some controls in the future in case, you know, people try to sort of game the system by uploading an audio file of their dishwasher and saying it's art. I mean, yeah, but I'm not worried about that too much.
No, okay. But one thing I was thinking was that couldn't you argue that if you are an artist who is getting a lot of streams, then it would be more profitable to be on a regular type of streaming service, because you never get to own the track on Spotify, for instance. You just keep streaming. So if you're getting like millions and millions and millions of streams, then that would be more profitable in the long run.
Not really, because if you look at the numbers, we've got some calculations on our stream to own information page. It's actually wrong. It's the number is much higher. We were very, very conservative, very generous with the way we calculated it. And the numbers on our site say that it takes 150 streams to reach the same price as a download. It's really closer to 200, maybe even 250. We're going to have to go back and redo the numbers. It's really difficult to get meaningful data as to what they're actually paying, because it's all over the map. I've spent way too much time researching this, and it's almost impossible to find a definitive number. A couple hundred plays of the same song to equal the price of a download, and with Resonate, it's 9. So, conservatively, we project that artists could earn 2.5 times, but it could be much higher than that. It could be more like 5 to 10, and we're going to redo those numbers until we've got a lot more data around, you know, actual listening habits and patterns and stuff. But it's a way more economical than any other service.
Okay. And could you explain a little bit more about the blockchain technology? The artists gets paid instantly when they're streamed. Is that correct?
They get the accounting happens instantly. Like, oh, the credits show up in their account instantly, so they have like immediate data. But it's going to take a while before it's an instant payment, because the only way you can do that is in crypto, and that gets super complicated. I do think we're going to evolve there, but I think it's going to probably take at least a year and a half to get there, because it's extremely complicated. You have to balance out, first you have to have a cryptocurrency that's stable against fiat, and then you've got to have an inefficient way for people to buy and trade it. And it's really not, I mean, it's not a user-friendly market on the crypto world. So it's going to take a little while for them. But in the meantime, it's all, you know, up their balance with euros or pounds or dollars, and then that's what the artist would get paid in.
Yeah. And you also use a smart contracts. Is that correct?
We're building a system for a catalog licensing framework, which does work with smart contracts. And so in that scenario, the most common example is if you want to split up the monies amongst your bandmates on a per song basis, you know, one song it's 50-50, another one it's 60-10, 10-20. You could do stuff like that. But it can also, a smart contract can also be used for things like this is free under certain conditions and costs money under these conditions. So this is also something that's going to take time to evolve because it's another utterly different paradigm from what we have now, but we're working on it.
Okay. Also, I mean, you know, curation in the form of playlisting is also a very big thing on the other services. But as I understand it, you don't really like algorithms with regards to music discovery. Is that correct?
Yeah, I think my hope is that we'll never have any algorithms, which is kind of a bold statement. You know, I'll give you an example. Liz Pelly, who is has to be my favorite journalist in music today, she did an expose on this campaign that Spotify had running, or maybe it's still going, at some partnership with Smirnoff for vodka. And it was all about gender balance. And she did an exhaustive research process, very meticulous, and like with multiple brand new accounts. And what she found is that the algorithms reinforce the chances that you're going to hear a male artist over a female artist. Unconsciously, the way the system's designed, it creates these self-reinforcing feedback loops that end up benefiting certain artists over others. And in a lot of cases, it happens to be those that are male versus female. So that's an example of how algorithmic bias and the structure of systems can lead to some really bad end results. So my hope is that we'll be able to really offer such a powerful set of curatorial tools that it won't become necessary to discover music through an algorithm. And in the end, I think this is the deeper meaning of our project is that it's about community. And one essential element are curators. When I look at my own personal music catalog, a huge percentage of it comes from two or three people that I know. And they were the curators in my life. They were the couple of friends that said, you need to listen to this. And when I did, it blew my mind. And so we've only seen the beginnings of that with playlist culture. We're going to take it a whole lot farther.
But so that's you plan on using the community more, so they can kind of curate to each other, so to speak.
Yeah, but it's got some very unique aspects to our service, which they won't get anywhere else. I'm going to wait to describe what that is until it's launched. Yeah.
But I mean, moving on from that, I mean, I've read you. You've talked a lot about like inclusion and diversity with regards to Resonate. Like, you want to create an inclusive environment. What does that mean? Like, more specifically,
it's across the board. I mean, it's about what's going to go out in terms of our promotional efforts, but it's about looking at what are the structures of our systems. So can we build them in a way that is not going to support one type of artist? It's things like that. But to me, it's also about a long-term vision of, you know, looking at some of the systemic problems that exist both in music and in tech. So it might be that, like, one of the things we're very, very cautious about is gender diversity on the panels that we speak on, because the music industry has been horrible in this regard. You know, having these all male panels, or having three guys and one woman, or four guys and a woman, it's been historically really, really bad. Sherry Hughes, another great music journalist, who did a long analysis on that and found how horribly biased the industry is towards men. So, you know, this is a way that we can stand out and make a difference. But I'm also, like, thinking long-term in terms of building up programming resources and going into communities that don't historically have any outreach in that regard, and finding clever ways to find the best and the brightest minds. So again, these are things that are kind of more long-term, so not much point in getting into too much detail at this point, but it's something that we're constantly asking ourselves questions about and exploring. We're living what we say, what we speak.